We promise to give you the new guidelines for pain control for adults. Where are we going to find it this week?
Find out today on Medical History Mysteries.
Welcome to Medical History Mysteries, everyone. I'm Pam Maragliano-Muniz, Chief Editor for Dental Economics. And with me, as always, couldn't do it without you, Tom Viola. What's going on?
Good to see you again, Pam. Thank you so much for allowing me the opportunity to work with you and do this. You know, it's one of my highlights of my career is doing these little 5 to 7 minute videos with you. And I'm so happy when people come up to me and say, hey, I saw you on that video with Dr. Pam. Makes me feel good to know that you and I are making a difference out there. So.
Oh my gosh, I love it so much. And to be honest with you, I get to learn every single week. So thank you so much. So last week we talked about updates or maybe lack thereof of guidelines for pain control and pain management for pediatric patients. And so there was kind of so much to talk about. We couldn't really hit any new updates on adults. So we're doing it today. So let's talk about the new guidelines that the ADA have put out regarding pain management for adults. What's new, what's not?
Well, what's old is new again. How about that, Pam? So as it turns out, after publishing the original guidelines for managing acute pain in children last year, earlier this year, the ADA published their guidelines for treating postoperative acute pain in adolescents, adults, and older adults. Now, there were two guidelines, right? One for treating pain from simple and surgical tooth extractions, and one for treating the quote-unquote toothache, you know, pulpitis, right? So let's talk about both. Nothing really has changed other than the dosing. So as we talked about last time, what changed for pediatric recommendations was that the dosing wasn't there. You had to calculate the dose on your own. Now what's changed with the adults is that the dosing is included, but it may not be the dose you've been using historically. So if you can take an NSAID, right? NSAIDs are contraindicated. For a simple extraction, the ADA says, you know, just go with acetaminophen at a full therapeutic dose of 1,000 milligrams. For a surgical extraction, the ADA says you can use acetaminophen at the full therapeutic dose of 1,000 milligrams, or you could use a 325 milligram dose of acetaminophen plus a 325 milligram dose of acetaminophen in combination with an opioid of your choice, usually 5 to 7.5 milligrams of hydrocodone or 5 milligrams of oxycodone. That's entirely your choice, but that's only if an NSAID is contraindicated. Now, if you can use an NSAID, then you have a couple options. Option number one, go with ibuprofen alone, but here the recommended dose is 400 milligrams. That's different from the past, okay? Normally we prescribe higher doses than that. If it's naproxen you choose, it's 440 milligrams. Now, you could just go along with that, but if you discover that as first line therapy, that's not enough, and you wanted to give a little more pain management or pain control, you could add acetaminophen at a dose of 500 milligrams to either the 400 milligrams of ibuprofen or the 440 milligrams of naproxen. Now, if you find that that's inadequate for treating your pain, if you went with the 400 milligrams of ibuprofen or the 440 milligrams of naproxen by itself, you can now add acetaminophen 325 milligram plus a dose of acetaminophen 325 milligram in combination with an opioid. Again, either 5 to 7.5 milligrams of hydrocodone or 5 milligrams of oxycodone.
So opioids aren't dead. We're still prescribing opioids now.
Absolutely. Now, if you went with the second option, which was 400 milligrams of ibuprofen or 440 milligrams of naproxen plus the 500 milligrams of acetaminophen, and that's not enough, start over, okay? You do the 400 milligrams of ibuprofen or the 440 milligrams of naproxen, but now add 325 milligrams of acetaminophen and 325 milligrams of acetaminophen in combination with an opioid, either, again, 5 to 7.5 milligrams of hydrocodone or 5 milligrams of oxycodone. So opioids are not dead. And to be honest, Pam, we've had this conversation before, you and I, and I'll, again, stick my foot out for someone to run it over and say, what? I'm still a proponent of prescribing opioids. I know that that's counter to what a lot of people say these days in this space. And there are a lot of people who are speakers in this space that may not be pharmacists or pharmacologists. I throw no stones at them. But being the pharmacist, I can tell you that in the all the years I filled prescriptions, I knew a lot of dentists who prescribed opioids and who treated patients' pain with an opioid. And an opioid never left the pharmacy. The dentist wrote the script. The patient never filled it. But even so, that ended up helping the patient through the pain. Why? Because the knowledge that the prescription was there waiting for them was the light at the end of that tunnel. It was the hope. It was, okay, I don't know how bad this pain is going to get. I'm very afraid. I don't know if it's going to get worse. What am I going to do? But you know what? I know that prescription's waiting for me. That is going to give me the courage to hold on a little longer. You know, I can withstand this pain a little longer. And if I find I can't, I'll get that prescription filled. That prescription for that opioid is the escape strategy from the pain. And so you wrote the script. It never got filled, but you treated their pain anyway, because you provided them that hope. You didn't prescribe them an opioid, folks, in that case. What you really prescribed them is hope, a way out. And that's what matters at the end of the day. All we want to do is get our patients out of pain as quickly and as effectively as we can, because fear becomes a demotivator for people to seek dental care. And that's only going to lead to negative outcomes. We want to treat pain effectively and efficiently so people would want to come see us. Sometimes that happens even when the prescription you wrote for the opioid ends up being a placebo. Now, some people do fill the script, and that's fine. But dentists historically have written prescriptions for opioids for 6, maybe 10 tablets tops. Okay, maybe that's not enough to contribute to the opioid epidemic. Maybe it is. But when medical doctors are out there prescribing 180 tablets at a time, I think 6 tablets represents a very small portion of what might contribute to that opioid epidemic. And at the same time, people don't fill the script. If they do, they can't wait to get rid of it because they know that those opioids potentially are likely to fall into the wrong hands, maybe, or you know, they have kids, they have grandkids, get them out of the house. Now, here's my other point. We decide, nope, I'm not going to write that opioid. I don't care what Viola says, because any prescription I write for an opioid contributes to the opioid epidemic. I will tell you what also happens, again, based on my experience. 3 outcomes. Outcome number 1, the patient suffers in pain and will leave an indelible mark on them the rest of their lives. They will always associate you with incredible pain and they will avoid you. Number 2, they will take more ibuprofen and acetaminophen than they should, because what other option have you given them? And number 3, that's not it. Then the third option is they get an opioid from a friend or a relative who has an opioid set aside from a previous procedure, whatever it was. It may not be the right opioid for them. It may not be the right directions for use for them, yeah, but they're going to get it anyway. And that's the definition, right? The definition of the word diversion is taking an opioid that wasn't prescribed for you. And diversion contributes to the opioid epidemic. So to kind of go back to what we were talking about earlier, when it comes to treating simple pain, you know, opioids are still very much part of our strategy for managing pain in dentistry in adults and adolescents.
But they're still used as a last resort, or, you know, or when they're needed. So I think that we're still talking about careful management of it. So I have to ask, though, when does a prescription turn up on the prescription monitoring program? Is it upon writing the prescription or filling it?
So it's upon the prescription being filled, because the information in most, if I'm not correct on this, correct me, guys, in the comments, but I'm pretty sure in every state, the prescription drug monitoring programs only record the data when the pharmacy fills the prescription. The pharmacies transmit the data to the database. But see, that's why I love this system, because we're going to prescribe opioids, right? But we're going to prescribe them appropriately. And this is the problem dentists have, because some dentists understand, obviously, how to write a prescription for an opioid, but they don't maybe understand how to identify a patient who has at risk for substance use disorder, who then for should not get an opioid. But we don't get training in that necessarily. So yeah, I know how to write a script, but no, I don't know not to write that script for that patient because they have this tendency towards substance use disorder. And if you don't mind, Pam, I want to just kind of switch gears over to the other protocol for treating toothache. or symptomatic pulpitis that's reversible, you know, it's going to be the same thing. Okay. Yes, in both protocols, the use of a local anesthetic agent is sometimes recommended. So bupivacaine, let's say, or articaine to get the patient out of pain. But if you're looking for a change here, it's the same guidelines. Again, can't use an NSAID. We use acetaminophen, as we said, full dose of 1,000 milligrams or 325 milligrams of acetaminophen plus 325 milligrams of acetaminophen plus an opioid. If you can use an NSAID, it's the same thing. An NSAID alone as the doses we said before, an NSAID plus acetaminophen, again, at the dose we said before. And again, if that's not pain management enough, we go with the 325 milligrams of acetaminophen plus 325 milligrams of acetaminophen in combination with an opioid. So don't take my word for it. Go to the Journal of the American Dental Association. Go look at the guidelines. They're there for all to see. Print them out, slap them on the wall in your office, and you know, you'll always know exactly what to prescribe and how much to prescribe. But I guess the overall message here was, don't be afraid to prescribe opioids because they're still very much a part of our pain management strategy in dentistry.
That's really great advice. And it's really interesting because I think some for us, I mean, I know opioids is a last resort, but I think some of us are like, no, opioids are off the table because I don't want to contribute to the problems that we have in this country. So it's really great advice to know that it's still a tool in our tool belt. We're obviously going to prescribe it carefully. Always refer to the prescription monitoring program when you do, but know that it's there for you when you need it. So thank you for dissecting those guidelines for us. I know sometimes when we read them, they're just like hard to digest all of them. So it's really nice how you can like break it up, make it easy for us to understand and allow us to just do better for our patients. So thanks.
Well, the rule of thumb, Pam, to walk away with is we never prescribe an opioid in place of, we always prescribe it in addition to.
You got that? That's gold right there. Thank you.